IVM.
If you ever find yourself worried about what goes on the internet in terms of harassment and how to protect yourself from that kind of stuff, you can check out Akansha Against Harassment. It goes on the IVM podcast app every Thursday.
Stories, we've got stories. They're a little bit of funny and a little bit of dissimilar. You wanna hear them? It's got humans. They're sitting in a box and talking bold at worth all life.
Law school was a very interesting part of my life.
Oh yeah, you did law.
I did law. I did 5 years of law.
And now I do
comedy throughout law also. My entire adult life has been spent doing both of these things. And so law school was interesting for several reasons, because the thing is, in the West, law is like the degree of the undecided. And in India also, it is to an extent that, because in the first 6 months of law school, you will see everybody from medical students who've taken admission because their medical results haven't come out yet. To just faces that you will never see again, and you will find out they're doing jewelry design now. And it was nice to see that, because I wasn't interested in doing law. The only other person though who stuck around through and was equally uninterested in law was Rafael Pereira. And he's a man of many paradoxes, because he didn't want to be a lawyer, but he still interned and did all the law things that I wouldn't do. He doesn't want to do law, but he still got his practicing license, his sanat. He wanted to work in theatre and events, and he does, but he's also doing his LLM from the States.
What is LLM?
LLM is the master's version of LLB.
Okay.
Don't ask me the full form of either of those, because I missed that lecture.
5 years, yeah.
I learned a lot of other stuff, like the option of puberty in Islamic law and all, like, but I don't remember this part. Anyway, my point is, once law school ended, you know, I went about my comedy and Rafael went about his stuff, and our paths became very close to one another again when I got the office that we are in right now at Lasun. It was right next to Rafael's office. And I thought to myself, oh my God, you know, this is so great. You know, me and Rafa can hang out now. And this is the third time I'm meeting him in the last year. And it's at this recording.
Yay.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to Rafael Chris Pereira.
Hello, hello, hello.
What a sultry voice. I've met him after like 2 years for the first time. So yeah, it's even more out of access rather. I remember Rafael because I remember I was covering Mahindra Blues Festival.
Yeah.
And my only wish was to like meet Buddy Guy.
Yeah.
Post show, but that didn't happen.
Okay.
But guess who was chilling with Buddy Guy on Facebook? Rafael.
Yeah, man. Rafael has if you go through his timeline, he's chilled with a lot of very interesting. He's chilled with Axl Rose. And who did Axl Rose actually want a gym in his green room?
He did have a gym in his green room. Like, they fly a treadmill around the world.
Oh shit.
I mean, I can tell you that because at that point I was no under obligation not to tell you that. So, but a few other artists I won't be able to mention what they're the ones are.
So. Now I'm interested.
Yeah, I know.
But yeah, I mean, feel free to ask me about Buddy Guy. Maybe. I can tell you he does not exercise before.
Well, I think he smokes up though.
No.
No? Oh shit.
I don't, that kind of like playing needs you to be kind of all there. I think the most like dedicated artists in the world don't get that high.
But wasn't blues born out of like
reefer?
Reefer, yeah.
No, man, I think it was like operation of,
it was just like jazz slowed down and just like them taking it easy and then like Ray Charles doing a shit.
What? No, jazz came after the blues.
Yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. New jazz was the baby of the blues. Jazz was happier blues.
That's okay. Then it's the other way around.
Yeah.
Then stoners who took cocaine and did jazz then.
No, it was I think blues was the sad black people music.
Let's talk to the expert about this.
Yeah.
I'm not really an expert on that. I'm an expert on how to entertain those men who entertain you all. So
tell us about that, right?
Yeah.
Like, how did that happen? Because as Akash was saying, like, you were deep into law, you were doing your internship and everything. And then all of a sudden, like, you were also forming one of the biggest entertainment events company, rather, like handling the clients, rather.
Yeah, so how it all started was while I was in school. Like, I'm lucky to have had the sense to get an early start on things.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons for that was, I just wanted to get out of home. Like, I was the worst kid in the world. I created problems for my parents, for my sister, anyone who got in contact with. I was like the opposite of the Midas touch was what I had. Like, was like, so, and I would do okay in school in the, you know, in the, in English.
That's a Makapau.
That's a Bandrat.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, so like a lot of my secondary education in school was a period when my dad was fighting cancer. So it was like multiple relapses and stuff like that. Things were tough at home and I had no real release. At that same time, it was like school plays, annual day, stuff like that.
Hmm.
And then I saw these friends of mine in the ninth standard working on something called Celebrate Bandra.
Yeah.
Which for me at that point, I'd been watching for 2 to 3 editions. It is biennial. So it was biennial at that time. And I said to myself, if they're working on it, why can't I?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So again, I was lucky because these were friends of mine like Scott and Mitchell. They're sons of the founders of Fountainhead MKTG, which is the company that conceptualized Celebrate Bandra and created Celebrate Bandra at that time. And one day, one of my friends, I kept pestering them. And one of the reasons we wanted to work on Celebrate Bandra was at that point, Red Bull's competitor called Power Horse was in the market.
Okay.
And these guys were taking home cans of Power Horse and like, yeah, whoa, it's so much fun to work and things like that. I'm like, I'm listening to Marathi Barakadi and I mean, not Barakadi at that stage, but whatever. I'm listening to textbook tales and going for tutions and y'all are working on events. Like, so I went out.
I was wondering how late Barakadi was talking to our kids. Like, ye sab bol ke tum log use kar lo, then you can get by.
Yeah. So, advantages of playing sports. Get by with Barakadi till 9th standard. So
you played hockey, no, in school?
Yeah, so I played hockey in school. I was the backup B team goalkeeper. So it kind of tells you I didn't really excel at. I did everything. Didn't excel at. So I was like the jack of all trades, master of none example in the brief answer in English in school. Like you could write my name and the teacher would give you full marks for writing my name. But if I wrote my name, like 75% marks you would.
The Midas touch continues. Yeah, so,
but yeah, so being captain of the B team in the goal to being assistant sports captain of the school playing only one sport. It's like, shit, but I mean, yeah, so the event started in the 9th standard, got into Celebrate Bandra, then worked on the next edition by the time I was in the 11th standard. Kind of worked my way through college. I can't say I paid my way through college because that wouldn't be true. I earned the equivalent to pay my fees and some other stuff doing events, but I didn't physically say, oh, you know what, these are my earnings, let me pay my fees. That would be a lie.
Mm-hmm.
But I kind of, that gave me the confidence that, hey, you know what, I can kind of support myself to do this much.
Yeah.
And theater continued. It was in the 11th and 12th standard where I got into Barakadi theater, which Marathi theater. And I joined the Natya Vibhag of DG Ruparel College.
Nice.
You still can't even pronounce it properly.
Ruparel, guys.
No, Natya.
Natya, yeah. I can't say. I mean,
Ruparel.
Sorry. I mean, yeah. I used to play the guy who used to speak in English.
That's always convenient.
Yeah.
But I think Marathi theatre is pretty strong in terms of, even at college levels, the kids who come to practice, and I've worked with some of them, they're just like too mind-blowing, they're too animated.
Yeah.
Not too animated, but like the right amount of animated.
I think it's the, for some reason, at the intercollegiate level, you are brought into Marathi theatre with principles of method acting.
Mm-hmm.
Ruparel's drama department follows the principles of Pandit Satyadev Dubey.
Mm-hmm.
And they follow it to the core. From the time you're brought in, you learn a piece called Andayug, like a full patch from Andayug, and you're It goes just like andayog kadachit na likha jata yadi uska likhna na likhna meri bas ki baat reh gayi hoti, and that's pretty much all I remember from the rest
now
of the
translate
film.
For us.
And I don't even know what andayog means.
It sounds like blind war.
I was thinking that's burji power type scenes.
Anda, it's anda.
Anda, sorry, that's my fault.
Yeah.
Can't take the Catholic out of.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's Catholic.
So, no, but it must have been a bit of a culture shock, right? Like in terms of.
It was. So I wanted to go to St. Xavier's College. Mm-hmm. I found myself in DG Rupara.
Yeah.
But I have this thing that I'll make the most out of any situation.
Yeah,
that,
make
that,
hay
that, yeah.
When the sun shines. I make gay when the sun shines. I'm sorry.
क्यों तू बारिश होता है तो नहीं है क्या क्या बोल रहा है तू
हाँ नहीं गीला है सब कुछ
yeah I mean it doesn't matter but yeah I mean but that was the year the Department of Education decided to test out the online admission process.
Oh yeah, I remember. We were in the
so,
same batch, right?
Yeah, yeah. Same batch. So I got into Elphinstone College and I was like, that building looks insane. Looks like I'm walking, like I could walk in with a lawyer's gown into Elphinstone College and people would call me Harry Potter. It was like, that was the surrounding. Like, where?
That was your first list.
What class are you going to? Gryffindor.
No, Potions is a class.
Yeah, Gryffindor is a house.
Get a Harry Potter right.
It does not matter. Have you been to that? Yeah. But the moment you enter that building, it feels like you're working in a sanatorium. You know, like, it smells completely like that. And so Elphinstone kind of, a lot of people who went to Elphinstone in the past, my mom got me to talk to them. And they told me, you know, Elphinstone was for the stoners and things like that. They were like, it's an amazing place. The Elfies always had it against the Xavierites, this, that. And it's like,
yeah, but that was like 30 years ago.
Yeah, and now it's lost all of that. So, I mean,
yeah.
But through online admission, I rejected Elphinstone and then I got Ruparel and I said, maybe I can make something work here. Kind of disappointed through my first week there, but then there were these huge chalkboards in the, say, kind of the entrance arch campus of the college, the main building of the college, let's call it that. And on those chalkboards, so I didn't find out about the Marathi Drama Club because it was written in Marathi. Yeah, so, but then later someone explained to me, you know, there is a kind of a theater group in college. I figured that out.
All that Marathi for nothing, I feel.
Yeah, like. But the other side was something related to sports. So, and it wasn't hockey, it wasn't football, it was softball and baseball.
Oh, okay.
So I got into that. I started playing
baseball
and softball.
Wow, this is so absurd.
No, I completely get you. I played baseball in school.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a team which never
right,
got
now
to
you
play.
Now you can teach me the rules about that game.
Dude, so. I still don't understand. Yeah. All I know is I used to be a pitcher, so I used to just aim for people's heads.
Okay. It was just strike that. One, strike two, and three come from there. That's all I know.
Strike out.
Concussion one, concussion two. No, but, you know, interestingly, even through that online process, I got into Sydenham first,
uh-huh.
which was my dad's alma mater. Alma mater.
Yeah.
So, mater. Alma mater. Tomato. Hey, you say matter, I say matter.
Matter.
So, when I was in Sydney, through that, and it was my dad's alma mater, and I was there for a week. F*** you, man. Don't judge me. I am crazy. I got there and again similar experience, except Sydenham doesn't even look nice from outside. The only nice thing was that I made a couple of friends and I ate some really good sandwiches. But other than that, like the Marathi theatre group in Sydenham was the most prominent one. And then I got into HR because I played the drums. So they needed a drummer for Malhar. So invariably I ended up going to Xavier's only. Even though it was through HR. But anyway, so when I got to HR, theatre completely eluded me. Because in HR there was that choices there and there's a whole hierarchy and you have to work your way up. And if you're not Parsi, that's definitely going to be slower than if you are. So did you feel like the fact that you were not, were they inclusive with you? Were they like... Because like with HR, when I wanted to get into the cultural scene, they were very like reluctant to even let me in because I was not like them, you know.
Oh, I was a god. Like, I mean, The thing is, I didn't speak Marathi that well. So anything I said in Hindi or Marathi
was funny.
Yeah. People found me funny. I found that amazing.
Give us an example.
Like,
oh, he. My favorite thing he does is that I. You remember the I.
Can't say
AI. Udtya pakshanche. Ginto mi.
Udtya panchiche.
Yeah, and things like. So they would come up to me with every day I would be excited.
Which means flying birds, pubic hairs.
I count them.
Great.
So every day they would come up to me with something new and I was excited. I thought it's my first dialogue in the first play. But it would be this new phrase of cussing in Marathi. So the other one was like, Tujhi aai padli matkyat. Something like
your mom farted in a pot.
Yeah. And I would use this to my advantage because in some stratas of society, it's considered impolite for men to abuse in front of women or to talk about sex in front of women and stuff like that. And this was, I found myself in that kind of friend circle. So they couldn't mention something like this. But me on the other hand, radical Catholic boy walking into the heartland of Sena Bhavan and MNS. At that point, it was a big tussle.
Yeah.
But I was like saying things like this to women, like, Tujhi aai padli matkya. And they would look at me like, that was the best pickup line I've heard. It was like that. But I mean, it was the accent. The accent in Marathi kind of killed it. Like the guy in Three Idiots speaking in there, I was like, better looking, you know. But,
true.
But,
but that's one thing I've realized about Rafal. He can like get into any group and he just blends in. Like, I don't know if you remember this one time, but we had a classmate called Bhanat. Mm-hmm. And it was her birthday. And Rafal was, I mean, I get there and he's there. And then, like, I look away for 15 minutes and then, boom, it's Rafal with Pagdi dancing with her dad.
Nice.
And I'm like, wow, what an assimilation.
It's like.
And he can't even pronounce Chakde Fate.
Yeah, it was. There was another dialogue associated with that also, but yeah, so that really helped me at a point in my life where it gave me some sound principles of theater, which I use till date. Mm. It helps me in all. I think theater can help you in any walk of life. It's just something that you define how you use it. You define the ways in which it can help you.
Yeah. No, I completely agree with this. I feel like it's any art form, like the disciplines that underlying any art form are usable. They are completely usable everywhere in life.
Yeah.
Like even with stand-up, just being an observational person, being more sensitive to your environment helps a lot. Like even with musicians, like discipline at the end of the day, right? Like it boils down to that. So I feel like I completely agree with you on that.
And also because I remember we used to be at Hive a lot when I first started comedy, and you would be in the back room, you know, like trying to like kind of go through all the jokes I was cracking and then give me very critical feedback because you have a keen understanding of comedy and the arts in general. So how was that build up in that?
So at that point, I never really did professional English theatre. I've not done professional English theatre. What I've done is at a collegiate level or a showcase level at an NCP, a youth theatre kind of. It was something called Zest, where moving into
college,
I found myself at a similar, a similar position as junior college because in junior college, I technically did get into Xavier's.
Yeah.
But I didn't bother to go and check the waitlist. I didn't bother to. So the people who were on the waitlist after me, I found them in Xavier's 1 month after I was in Drupal. I'm like, okay, that's a disappointment. Can I switch? No. But again, at the 12th standard, it's like in India, we postpone decisions and we try and postpone these decisions by giving you the illusion of I'm trying to narrow it down for you and put you in a space where you're comfortable, that being art, science and commerce, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But those spaces are like if you're an arts, the humanities, or I'm a BA.
What do you do with a BA?
I will look for a job in humanities. What is humanities. The closest thing to humanities is human resources. do you do that? No, but at that point, these were the things in my mind. And what had played on my mind was some aptitude test that I had gone for. In the 10th standard, in the 12th standard, completely different results.
Yeah.
Like, and they tell you it's methodology, you have changed as a person and stuff like that. And
Mine said that I should be a farmer.
A farmer?
Yeah. It had number one priority was farmer, then physics, and then hospitality.
Wow.
So it was like three completely random things.
I didn't know aptitude tests could tell you, it could be a farmer.
No, it was like the one of those Oxford ones that knows, man. They mail it to the place and then
what
it
did
comes.
You have to do for that? Answer a bunch of questions.
Oh, like it was like 3 hour long exam, dude.
Okay.
And my mom and dad thought that in 12th, if I got that guy, I would get some too correct behavior would happen and I would not want to be a musician anymore. So, but that didn't work because I still wanted to be a musician after that. And we didn't buy the full package.
Okay.
The full package is where you also make sure you get into the university.
This
is
the one. That part they forgot. That part they left out.
Yeah, they just did the one where they tell you that you should be going to university, which was not very helpful. And then 12th, depression and whatnot was going on. And then in first year, when I got to law school, I met the theater group again, which was because usually that's what happened. Like even in law school, I didn't get in. I've never gotten into a college because of my marks. So 11th was culture quota, first year law school was
management
quota, because they didn't have anybody doing cultural shit in the college, so they're like, we would like you to come and basically play drums for Malhar, but we didn't do Malhar, we weren't that cool. And so at that point I was very insecure. I wasn't particularly happy with where my life was at. The depression was still there. In the middle of all that, somehow Rafael tricked me into acting for the next 4 years or something. Like every year I wanted to get on to the theatre team as a writer, funny content, funny plays and stuff. And then after about, like, I don't know when, I know, still don't remember how, but like I found myself acting the lines after like the first week. And every year I would be like, Rafael, I just want to do lights and sounds and I'll help you write. I don't want to do acting. And then every year I would be acting.
That is a power you do possess, though.
Yeah.
Like to just like calmly through your very sultry voice tell people that they have to do something and they get hypnotized.
Yeah, I don't know how he does it. How do you do it? Why do you do
like
it?
Like when you convince me to join and work for Hive. That was both of you, mother. But I remember, like, you took me to one corner and then again this guy, after you talked to me, he takes me to another corner, and I found his reason more solid in because like he believed in Sudeep's vision.
Yeah,
we all did. So it was quite something. And then like even there working, I remember it was quite a lot of fun, basically, because you can sing, you can act, you can do all of these things. And we worked on a project together which was called 3773 Marquee, which our friend Joshua and Ramneek composed. And so you can see the video where we both are in like alternate dressings. He especially in a spaghetti top. And I'm in
Rafael cross-dress more than you might think. I've actually seen him as a chick a lot.
I
mean, I'm confident about my sexuality, you know. I don't feel that if I'm seen in a dress, anyone would think me less of a man.
But it's, you know, it's interesting because when my mom ka episode also, when we were talking about cross-dressing, my mom very categorically said, you know, that Akash, if you ever cross-dress on television for a show, I will disown you.
Yeah.
And her logic is that the dress can't be the joke. The joke needs to be the joke. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So it's a very valid point.
Yeah. And I've seen you in drag a bunch. Do you ever feel like that line kind of gets placed? Do you ever wonder to yourself whether they're laughing at the joke or laughing at the dress?
To me, it doesn't matter. I don't think it does. If I've made them laugh, I'm not going to analyze and say, I mean, I'm not a comedian as such. So I don't analyze and say, hey, what did I do to get that laugh out of them?
Yeah, but then, you know, you're a savant hobby comedian then, because I've seen Rafael do, when we used to do Olio in college, I've seen him take out 2.5 minutes of laughs just on his face without saying anything.
Yeah, that was... So, I think what Akash is referring to is this one play. So, we formed this theatre group in our college and named it Lord Our Liaison. Which, if you... say it in a competition would be a lesson. And at that point, we had no resources in college. There was nothing. So our college was
was half a floor.
Yeah.
For 6 hours a day.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anything beyond 6 hours, you needed permission of the other college. You needed to write a letter and stuff like that. So after a point, we just had multiple draft letters in our bag ready. Sign it, write a date, write the number of the classroom, and then just give it in. And we were just playing with concepts. So we went to this competition called Olio, which is St. Andrew's theater competition. Yeah. I don't know if it happens anymore.
Oh, yeah?
I mean, it's had a bad response the past few years. Oh. Just colleges not turning up and stuff like that. The English intercollegiate theater scene has kind of
Didn't learn their barakadis well, that's why.
Yeah, I mean, maybe.
But Olio was quite the experience, though. Yeah. Like, I have never played a packed 700-seater with kids before. And we used to crush it, dude. We were the only comedy play.
Hmm.
Yeah.
The 4 years I was in college, we were the only comedy play every year, consistently funny.
Because so the first year we did it, we were eliminated.
Yeah.
We went and watched the finals, and I convinced these guys. I said, guys, we need to go and watch the finals and see what I'm talking about. You know, this is why we were eliminated. And we watched. What we realized is, I mean, the winning play was a comedy.
Mm-hmm.
We want to do comedy. We're not comfortable doing anything else. And we wanted to write, Akash wanted to write something else. And then we said, let's do comedy. And we came up with this play called Spare Ribs.
Mm.
So the theme of Olio that year was to create a play which was a fairy tale reinvented and retold.
Yeah.
So we picked the three little pigs and called it Spare Ribs.
And it was an absolute blast from start to end.
Yeah.
We didn't win that year, but we won hearts that year. Like, literally, it felt so so great to do that play.
You were the Amit Sanna of the competition.
We had a Harlem Shake at the end of the play.
Yeah.
This is back when the Harlem Shake was a thing. Yeah.
Everyone on stage just
losing their minds.
Yeah. And we did it within the runtime of the play. So they couldn't stop us from doing the Harlem Shake.
And that was the thing. They would try to censor us every year. Something or the other. And you can't do this and you can't say that. And every year it was so much fun trying to find a new way to.
Especially if you have a liaison cricket play.
Yeah. That's where Lasun Live came from. Because before we used to go on stage, we should barely ever get enough time to practice. In fact, the last play I did with y'all in fourth year was practiced. Maybe we did one full run through.
Yeah.
And then on stage, Rafael and I practically improvised the entire play.
Yeah.
Okay.
Where we won.
Nice. So the actual competition.
Yeah.
What was this play
we
about?
We won actually most of the things.
Yeah. It was everything except best actress, I think.
Yeah.
Which was funny because we had the exact same. So the play was based on, or the premise for the play was, Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson have settled in Bandra and they're here to solve the case.
No, that's fifth year. Fourth year was that they're trying to put up a play, but they don't have the money. So then they try different things to try and get the money. Where I'm the producer, so I tie up with a lingerie brand.
Yeah. That was a complete improv play. That play was basically blocks on stage.
Four blocks.
And kind of a Romeo and Juliet in
backstage.
Yeah.
And then at one point there was a song and shit. But here's what's really fun about that night. Because
so they improvised the whole play on the night.
Virtually. Because what happened is that nobody remembered their lines. Nobody even remembered blocking on the stage. So literally Rafael in the middle of the play would act like, hey, you come here. And the guy would walk into light.
Yeah, and pull him into light. Because he's standing in complete darkness trying to deliver dialogues. And like, just come here. So.
But we won it. We won Best Actor. We won Best Supporting Actor Male. We won Best Sound and Lights. We won the Best Play. So we crushed it.
And everything in the world is now right.
Well, no, but like it felt like a fairy tale. Like it was the last festival I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that with that ended like law school. Where we were also that. I shifted law schools after that.
Okay.
Because then, you know, comedy became full time. But what a trip, dude.
Yeah, so through college as well, once Akash moved into Rizvi, what really kept us close was the whole entertainment sector. I mean, Akash was getting into comedy heavily and we could see that. I think the first time you performed was at that college cultural event, right? Voyage.
Yeah.
When you perform comedy.
No. Voyage, I had done a song.
Oh, okay.
But the first time I did it was when we were doing Kaleidoscope.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And you killed it there. You.
Yeah, I came fourth. And then I did an open mic at Ibar and I came second.
Nice.
To Karunesh. So I was like wow, man, amazing. Fifteen saal haga.
So, yeah. And,
but you kept doing the event stuff through law school.
Yeah.
And then when law, but then you were, why were you, that's what I don't understand. You show equal amount of dedication towards everything. Like, there's no need for you to do an LLM from, where are you doing it from?
Berkeley.
See? What?
So, here's the thing. I chose law partly because of Boston Legal.
Makes total sense.
And partly because I didn't feel there was anything better to do. No one told me about a BBA and stuff like that. At that point, I don't think I would be interested.
I think William Shatner's eyes do that to you.
Yeah. I mean,
I want to play a spacecraft.
I prefer the other guy, Alan.
James Spader. Yeah, James Spader.
Ultron.
And so I picked law because I believed lawyers were perceived as one of two things. Not just one is everyone thinks lawyers are cheats, but they go to lawyers because they don't know something. So I feel knowledge is power. I've always felt that. So I said, if people perceive me to have knowledge of something, I have perceived power. So that's kind of why I did law. And I think that statement continues to hold true and will hold true forever. I did law. I got into criminal law. This interest for criminal law. So during the first 2 years of college, I didn't do any of the law activities. Like, I didn't do the moots that were mandatory and stuff like that. But then later on, I got into it. My professors kind of said, hey, you know what? You have some talent. You can really succeed as a lawyer. And I said, how? And they said, you know what? If you're not interested in the other mundane stuff, do a trial. And I said, a trial? Amazing.
Nice.
Researched the hell out of it. Read the CRPC, made my notes, spitting out sections at the judges.
Yeah. And that's it. That's interesting, because then after he got serious, it was like, you know, when one kid moves away, the parents focus on the other one. So all the professors turned their eyes on me and said, Akash, now look, Rafael is also doing. Now when will you finally...
Yeah.
But you really got it. You interned for a judge also in the middle.
Yeah, so I interned for a really long time, almost, I think, 8 months with a judge at the Bombay High Court. Again, on the criminal side, I interned with a counsel in the lower courts, in the magistrates' courts, working on 138 NI matters, which are basically check bouncing and stuff.
Was there ever a more gruesome case that you had to deal with?
When I was working in the Bombay High Court, there were a lot of rape cases, self-immolation cases, acid attacks. At that point, it was like that whole Shakti Mills period, right? So all these cases, even if they were going on for years, were now coming up saying, hey, you know what? That case got attention. Now all these cases should get attention. Yeah. The fast track courts came up for rape and stuff like that. So these cases were in the center of the court's attention and I was in the thick of it. So, I mean, it led to a lot of study in that subject. And I mean, my views on will and consent for another podcast, but
I wonder what podcast that is.
Yeah. Consent with Pereira.
Bandra League.
Will you or will you not?
But then you've also been like really involved with the comedy scene, dude. You've been at Hive, you worked at Hive. Everybody, I think, has been touched by Hive in some way.
Some way or the other.
Yeah.
I had heard about the Hive a bit. When you took me, so I'd been to one of those open mics, the Culture Shock open mics. But when you called me to the Hive when it was at Khar, I was kind of intrigued. I was like, whoa.
Because it had that magical feel. Yeah,
it had that vibe. And at that point, you explained what you wanted me to come in and do. Sudeep sat me down and said, this is the vision. And I believe if it's about the vision. If you believe in the vision, that's when you can work at a place. That's when you can work for someone else. And I believed in the vision at that point. I was ready to go out there and kill it and crush the cultural space and be the only hive or replicate. At that point, the vision was to replicate
the hive, yeah.
The hive,
mm-hmm.
create hundreds of hives across the country. And what I was assigned to do was go out, find venues and crack deals for comedy, yeah. open mics, music, cinema clubs and just do... Sell a
you
bunch of events.
You were like a worker bee pollinating the venues.
Yeah.
Because you're from a hive.
Yeah. Aww. That's very nice. Yes.
Yeah. Eventually, I didn't want my pollen too.
You can have your pollen and eat it too.
Yeah.
How about that?
And I was like, maybe I need some of that honey.
Do you, but like what were the some of the highlights of working in the hive? Because everybody has a lot of hive stories. Mm-hmm. But I think we can do like a whole separate episode of just the weird things that have seen, we've seen that have happened. Just the, like, do you remember the time Sudeep gave a rickshaw guy an hour-long slot to do a stand-up show?
Yeah, I remember.
No, I don't think I was there for that.
So he met some rickshawala. Yeah. He was damn funny.
I don't remember his name.
Abdul Narazak?
Some Muslim name, yeah.
And
sorry.
Man, we should explore this when Govind also comes down. This is like a mind trip. Dude, he came and he told us, like, he gave this one-hour audition to us in the middle, randomly just... noting down his achievements and the movie that he's done and showing me newspaper clippings. He starts singing songs from the movie.
Nice.
Yeah, Sudeep is that real, you know, that silent but violent kind of, you know, he's hilarious with his pranks.
Oh man, things. Yeah.
Yeah.
For a guy who's just like mostly somber and drinking coffee or stirring coffee,
yeah. Yeah.
He's got like a whole motion wheel in his head going, where, how do I with this person?
Yeah. Yeah.
How do I make his life miserable for 5 minutes and then like, you know, make him happy also?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and he, some of the shit he mumbles under his breath is like, it's like hilarious. And he'd be like,
so if you're hearing this, we love you a lot.
Yeah, yeah. We do.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
all things
but Sharon is better.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the highlights for me was this event we put together called the Bizarre Weekend.
Yeah.
In Pune.
Yeah.
And
I was there then working.
Yeah, and it was a complete loss.
Mm.
But the thing is, Sudeep didn't say, hey, you threw us under the bus or you caused this loss. Sudeep knew what we were going into and he kind of supported me and said, hey, you know what? Let's sit down after this and see what we can make of this. You know,
yeah.
We've kind of invested into this property. And I said, okay. And then we calculated it was a loss in excess of a lakh. Why we did it at that point, I mean, why I did it and how I convinced Sudeep and say Sharon to go ahead with it and... I can't really remember, but I just wanted to do it.
Hmm.
This was this whole project that I was heading in another city, in another venue, and he supported me, man. That was a high. So that's kind of where I got that confidence to say, hey, you know what? This is something that can work in the intellectual properties.
Because, see, the fact is that, you know, in this alt culture space that we have established, like Hive and now Cuckoo play such an important role.
Hmm.
But people don't realize that between Hive and Cuckoo, there was a lot of pitfalls that, you know, we were there for and we understand that it's a trial and error method, basically, to get forward.
It's so much was tried before.
Because while some people have the luxury of, you know, booking a venue in a mall and then putting a hospitality company behind that, it's just like hardcore labor of people who believe in the art form.
Yeah.
It's just like, it's pure... trying to like going on stage or like at least backstage every week trying to work something out, you know?
Yeah.
So
it's wonderful because like I remember when I was programming there, it was like Hive had become the place for, you know, like just for wandering artists and just people from, like, you could meet a physicist and you could meet a singer like in a span of 3 minutes And that was, I think, the most pop, because who else is willing to give space to some dude who wants to talk about mythology for an hour and a half to six aunties?
Yeah. Mm.
You know what I mean? Like, who is...
It was Prithvi Theatre Cafe on LSD.
Literally. Because
exactly how I would,
you remember those weekends that they used to have? The what is it called? The Hive Weekend?
Wait, the Collective then, or something. The Hive...
And so, but that weekend, the weekends were such mind-blowing events because either coding chal raha hai, either kuch shastriya sangeet chal raha hai. Oh my god, the first women's open mic was at Hive.
Yeah, the whole place was just like lit up in all different ways.
It's wonderful.
Yeah, so I think a lot of memories from Hive, and I'm glad that we could talk about that experience.
Yeah,
all three of us have been there around the same time. So
I think in the comedy scene, you'll find a lot of, especially in the comedy scene, you'll find a lot of people who worked at the Hive. Like if I have friends who are rappers and poets and stuff, it's because I worked at the Hive.
Yeah. But you know, like how it was so bizarre that it's the perfect slice of Bandra in Chuim Village.
Yeah.
So my fondest memory of Hive is not from inside the Hive, but outside.
Yeah. Remember that Vada Pav lady who used to cuss at everyone?
Yeah, but she was amazing, dude. She always keep like bhajia ready for me. She knew that at 7 PM I would come out and have some bhajia because we couldn't afford to have food at the Hive, even though we worked. So that was 1 year. But then like I remember once we walked outside after an open mic and Govind was there and Dhruv Chawla
he
was
got
there.
Roughed up.
He got roughed up. Not even roughed up. He got slapped and like got beaten by a stone. And we all had to like really work towards
kind. Wow.
And we were like, okay, now how do we take another route to Hive for Monday open mic? Because we were like very wary of the boys outside.
Yeah, so and so those elements were some of the reasons why it became hard for a Hive to kind of, you know, coexist.
Exactly.
And the philosophy, the ethos behind the Hive was to coexist, was to be that cultural center for everyone.
Yeah.
And
community fest. The Hive community fest. Yeah.
No, but the problem always invariably becomes that to be, to service the entire community, the community like immediately around you should want to do it. And because of disparity, it becomes very hard. Like, it, as many events as Sudeep would have for the kids from the mohalla and all, parents wouldn't want to send them
there. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, like, parking complaints and people being a bitch about, like, can't find a place or whatever.
Yeah. So, I mean, all of that kind of helped me in that.
Which he's perfected now by doing Cuckoo, I feel. Like, you know, in all the geographical constraints that we had, it's not there so much in Pali Hill as compared to Chuim Village.
But I still feel like the same vibe is also not there.
Yeah,
I mean, it's
true.
Not a place that's like home. It's a venue.
It's true.
Yeah. And I think these, taking back from those learnings is what I studied, and with my current partners, we discussed and paved the way for the Mumbai Assembly, you know?
Yeah.
It's not just solely based on that, but a whole lot of discussion. And really my partner Preeti Gaukar, she so because we have three verticals, there's a lot of work always.
But this is just with CADR or with Mumbai Assembly?
So I mean, with CADR, Nothing Regular and the Mumbai Assembly, there's so much work across the three companies that so the way we kind of work it out is each of us heads a vertical, heads one company or really drives that company. And with the Mumbai Assembly, really Preeti's creative vision has created this niche for us in the arts and culture space. And now we keep getting Facebook messages of what we're doing next. And sometimes we're not sure. We don't know. People may want something from us, but we're not sure if we want to do it. We're not sure. If we're doing a dance workshop and we're doing 10 dance workshops, do we do the 11th one just because it's successful? So those are questions we keep asking ourselves and some of the stuff. And doing some cool work, work which I consider to be cool. Unfortunately, what I consider to be cool is not necessarily what is
profitable.
Profitable.
Yeah. But I feel like, you know, like even with comedy, like if I spend, like last year I spent so much time writing that hour of dark comedy, which I can't do anywhere. I mean, there's no monetary benefit of doing an hour on why you think farmers should be killed, you know. So, but invariably, like, it's always been that handover of, you know, this is why I also perform at 25th anniversaries or baby showers, you know, because that drives the freedom for me to go to an open mic and just talk about whatever the hell else, you know. And the idea is maybe to then find a, carve out an audience for the things you love doing while you're still doing these other things to pay the bills.
Exactly.
So yeah, that being said, audience building is, I think, the toughest thing for any arts and culture organization.
Not if you're Zakir. Oh yeah, you mean organization,
I mean,
no, but that's true. Like, I agree, because an individual is easier to relate to than an organization. And I think that is definitely like a hard space. But at the same time, I feel like Bombay Assembly always has something going on.
Yeah, we don't have a fixed calendar. We don't program, look at a calendar and say, hey, we need to do 4 dance events a month. We need to do 5 theater events a month. Really, how we plan is, what can we empower next? What can we support next? What can we develop next? What can we do that's different? How are we doing things differently? And really, that's the Mumbai Assembly. And I can't sum it up in one statement. I can't sum it up in a paragraph. Because it's changing. We've not we're under no obligation to keep it the same. We're under no obligation to define it. And thank God, you know. And that's partly because we fund it ourselves. We are using the profits from our other two companies to do what we want. That means we're earning nothing from any companies. Like,
but how is... So, Kedar is doing really well in terms of... Kedar does manpower management.
Yeah, so Kedar is an event staffing company. And so, through college, I also, while working on events, say, production resources and operations personnel in different event companies, along with client servicing personnel in different event companies, would ask me, hey, I want you to work on an event, but I need 10 other guys. Can you help me out? And I would say, yeah, I can get all my friends. I would get all my friends and turn up for the event. It wasn't until later that a few people pointed out to me and said, hey, you know what? Something you can make money off. People do this and take cuts. I'm not going to take a cut.
Yeah.
Take a cut from someone else's money, and then economics struck me. it all hit me. DMU, all of that. But then I kind of saw this void in the event space. There are thousands of event companies just in Mumbai.
Yeah.
A new one is registered every week. Yeah. I kid you not. Mm-hmm. Right?
And most of them are just horrible to work with.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've had as comics, though, we avoid
every
events.
Yeah, all my other messages on Facebook is just like one event company.
And it's always like, it's literally a gali. Like, why are you doing this like an event person? Like, it's literally a bad word to say to someone. So I completely get that. But y'all are really nice to work with. I think we worked on the India Starts With I thing, where, I mean, it was not much, but they were super like prompt and y'all were helped it out, and it wasn't very expensive. And but you do a lot of large scale stuff.
Yeah, so again, the void in just manpower wasn't the only void. I pride myself on kind of identifying these voids and who's working, what's the lacuna, what's the loophole.
Yeah.
And that comes from the law, I feel.
I agree.
And I found this void for artist advancing, artist hospitality and logistics.
Yeah.
And on-ground management early.
Mm-hmm.
And there are tons of artist management companies who manage their own artists. But there wasn't any company that would manage the artists that you've booked for a festival or for a show for
you. So no bridging the gap is happening between them going to their room to them coming to the stage, basically.
Yeah. So I said, hey, you know what? I used to do this for 2 or 3 other companies. Maybe I can do this now and specialize in it. So that's what led to us going and meeting with the folks at Viacom 18 and saying, hey, you know what, give us our break on some of these shows. And they said, okay, Skrillex is coming to India and in a week. Put a plan together. I was ready next morning at 9 a.m. with a plan, saying, hey, you know what, 4 cities, here's how we'll handle it. And from there, we've done about 80-90% of the large format concerts and festivals in India.
Yeah.
It's quite something.
Yeah. And it's been amazing. That's the things I've done in the past, say 2015 to 2017.
It's been insane for, right? Like, after graduation, I don't think we had any time for anything. Like, life has really buzzed by, and I keep seeing like the Kedar office is growing. Like at one point Rafael randomly told me, hey, did you get those tables, by the way?
Yeah.
You didn't know? Like one day he's just like, hey, we need more tables in my office because there are too many people. I'm like, dude, we're still on one staff member.
And this is why this podcast exists, I feel. So for all those people who haven't spoken to in the past 2-3 years, we can bring them together.
Yeah, man, and we can catch up and tell stories, man. That's the whole thing.
That's what it's all about.
Well, hey man, thanks so much for coming on our podcast.
Yeah.
Who's the Naveen? Yeah. Great to be here, guys. Thanks. Thanks so much.
Bye.
Bye.
There she stands, a podcast addict. Outside the bank, having traveled several miles to get in with other poor souls like her. The journey, though daunting for this youngling, will have some comfort because she has downloaded her favorite podcast. You can see more of her species on ivmpodcasts.com, your one-stop destination where you can check out the coolest Indian podcasts. Happy listening.